What do you call a man who lives in a £3 million house, has a string of properties abroad, and owns his own luxury yacht? The answer apparently is bankrupt, or at least it is if you're John Palmer, one of the nastiest villains the Cook Report ever crossed swords with, and a man who seems to have really profited from a life of crime. This lavish and secluded mansion in Essex is home to John Palmer, con man, money launderer, and violent thug. With an estimated personal fortune of almost £400 million, he was, for many years, wealthier than the Queen.
John Palmer's lifestyle was film star, you know, premiership footballer lifestyle. It's the huge house, it was helicopters, it was, you know, private jets, it was everything that you would expect somebody who had, you know, several million pounds behind them.
In 1994, we set out to discover where Palmer's millions came from. It was a trail that took us halfway around the world and would eventually help put Palmer behind bars. Palmer first earned notoriety for smelting down gold bullion from the £26 million Brinks Mat robbery in a garden shed at his then country estate near Bath.
When we raided John Palmer's house, there were in fact two bars of gold there that were still warm, that had just come from the smelter. Unfortunately, John Palmer wasn't in residence at the time.
Palmer had fled to Tenerife. With his share of the proceeds from the Brinks Mat smelting, he started what would become one of the world's biggest timeshare businesses.
I'm in no hurry to go back. I'll take my time and go back when I'm ready and not when Scotland Yard's ready.
When he was finally brought back and tried, he managed to convince the jury that he hadn't known the Brinks Mat gold was stolen.
I was melting gold, but innocently. Never.
John Palmer returned to his growing timeshare empire in Tenerife, an empire he ruled with an iron fist.
People working for Palmer broke people's legs. They maimed people, gave them injuries that will be with them for the rest of their lives. So we're talking about really serious violence.
But timeshare wasn't Palmer's only crooked business. Our sources told us he was a major money launderer for other criminals. So we set up an elaborate sting, posing as international heroin dealers with an urgent need to clean their dirty profits. We set up a series of meetings and caught Palmer red-handed.
I can handle 50 million every 6 months, mm-hmm. but I need time. I can't do it next week.
Yeah.
I need time to. I want to be clear with it somehow. I want to be clear with lawyers, with everything, yeah. So there's no problems.
Yeah.
But when we confronted Palmer, he seemed overcome by amnesia.
Mr. Palmer. Roger Cook, I'd like to talk to you about money laundering.
About what?
Money laundering. We've been listening to every conversation you've had.
I don't know what you're talking about.
We just heard you offering to launder money. We'd heard you offering to launder at least £3 million. We have.
We have the tape of it.
Everything you said has been recorded.
It was a great expose. This was somebody quite clearly saying that he could launder millions and millions of pounds criminally.
That was 1994. As with many Cook reports, we shared our evidence with the police. 3 years later, John Palmer was under arrest for the largest timeshare fraud in British criminal history. But that was just the start of a new and extraordinary chapter in the Palmer story. In 2001, after a £1 million investigation, an Old Bailey jury convicted Palmer of defrauding thousands of people by selling them timeshares that didn't exist, or by conning them out of their existing timeshares in exchange for fictional alternatives, and then keeping the money.
It was then the biggest timeshare crime in Europe, and it still is. It has not been exceeded by anybody. Of the victims, about 17,000 were identified, and the actual loss to those 17,000 was well over £100 million.
Palmer was sentenced to 8 years in prison. His business partner and mistress, Christina Ketley, was given an 18-month suspended sentence for helping him run the scam. Palmer was also ordered to hand over his personal profits from the fraud, some £33 million. But thanks to the first of a series of official cock-ups, he managed to get that order quashed.
My instant reaction was anger, I mean, complete incredulity. We were just dumbstruck that it could have happened. You know, here was £33 million being returned to somebody who was convicted of serious crime.
The reason Palmer got his money back was that the Crown Prosecution Service had used the wrong forms to apply for the confiscation order.
We were just astounded, absolutely devastated, because it was based on years of investigation.
Cock-up number two involved Palmer's partner in crime, Christina Ketley. Despite being convicted and sentenced for her part in the fraud, the Department of Trade didn't disqualify her from running a company. So she went straight back to managing Palmer's timeshare. Meanwhile, in 2003, hundreds of Palmer's victims got a court judgment ordering him to pay £3.5 million in compensation.
Wriggled and squirmed at every opportunity to try and avoid paying. That's incurred much greater costs for the people that have been pursuing him, and still many of them have not been paid after a great many years.
Palmer's assets are carefully hidden behind a complex web of limited companies, many of them located in secretive tax havens. But what about that luxury mansion in Essex? It's worth at least £3 million, but it's owned by a limited company, which is owned by Christina Ketley, Palmer's partner in crime. 2 years ago, Palmer was released from prison on parole. One of the conditions was that he lived here at the mansion. To his victims, this very comfortable lifestyle added insult to injury.
He's been living it up in a life of luxury where I've been suffering. It doesn't make sense to me how I can get away with it.
We felt exactly the same, especially when we obtained eyewitness evidence which alleged that Palmer had breached his parole by visiting his former henchman in Tenerife. That's a serious criminal offence, so we alerted the Home Office, but it didn't even ask to see our evidence, and shortly afterwards released Palmer from his parole.
I've got no faith in our government or our justice service at all. I mean, it's disgusting. As I said, John Palmer should never be allowed out of prison until everyone's been paid off, because he's withholding information about all his assets.
We went in search of Palmer's assets. Here's one of them. A gleaming 115-foot yacht moored in Tenerife's Santa Cruz Harbour. It's worth at least $1 million. Someone's now paying to make it shipshape and ready to sail. But mention John Palmer's name, and no one wants to talk. Here's another Palmer asset, Island Village Timeshare Resort in Los Cristianos, Tenerife, the base for the record-breaking fraud for which he and Christina Ketley were convicted. Ketley now runs it, but when we called, no one apparently knew where she was.
There may be a good reason for Christina Ketley keeping a low profile. We've discovered that she's paying herself £2 million a year from the very same timeshare resorts that she and John Palmer used to cheat their many victims, many of whom haven't had a penny.
Next stop, Ketley's secure office in Brentwood, Essex.
Could I speak to Christina Ketley, please?
Who's calling?
My name is Roger Cook from ITV. I'm afraid there's nobody in the building at the moment.
Well, you're in the building.
Yes, I know, but I'm afraid she's not in the building.
When will she be in next?
Again? I don't know. She comes in as and when, so I can't honestly tell you which time she'll be in.
Well, we'd very much like to talk to her.
Right. Well, perhaps you could give her a ring or send her a letter.
If you give us a telephone number, we will give her a ring.
Oh, I don't have a telephone number, I'm afraid.
Next, off down the track to Foxdown Cottage, the £3 million mansion set in a country park with an elaborate security system. There was definitely someone at home, but no one was opening the gates. A grocery delivery. Perhaps they were expecting company. But rather than risk having our cameras get in too, whoever was giving the orders was apparently happy to go hungry. Meanwhile, and thanks to that series of official cock-ups, as far as the British authorities are concerned, Palmer and Ketley are free to enjoy all the luxury the fruits of their fraud can buy.
We asked three government departments, the Crown Prosecution Service, the Department of Trade, and the Home Office, to explain on camera how they managed to let Palmer and Ketley hang on to their ill-gotten gains and go on living the life of Riley. Their collective response? We never discuss individual cases.
One lesson we learned over 130 investigations and 13 long years of travelling the world was that no matter how well we caught our targets, bang to rights and on camera, there was every chance that the powers that be would somehow let them slip through their fingers. Then, in July, John Palmer was arrested.
Not by the British authorities, but by the Spanish police when he landed at Tenerife Airport. So perhaps at least one major villain may finally get all that's coming to him.